In this lesson, we want to review factoring trinomials when the leading coefficient is 1. So anybody that's ever taken an algebra course will have run across the topic where they deal with factoring trinomials into the product of 2 binomials. Okay, it's very, very common. So the easier scenario occurs when the leading coefficient is 1. So in other words, if we look at a trinomial, which again is a 3-term polynomial, like ax squared plus bx plus c, and this is just something generic, something you'd see in your textbook. If we let a be equal to 1, okay, if we let a be equal to 1, I'm saying that I have a coefficient of 1 on that leading term. So I'd have 1x squared plus bx plus c, which really 1 times anything is itself. So I could just write it as x squared plus bx plus c. This is the easiest case scenario, okay? And the reason for that is if I'm going to write this as the product of 2 binomials, remember, when we multiply binomials together using FOIL, it's first times first, right? First terms. That's the F in FOIL. So how do I get x squared? It's just x times x. I don't need to figure that out. That's already figured out for me. I just need to figure out this spot and this spot, okay? So that eliminates a lot of the work that you're going to come across when you deal with something where the leading coefficient is not a 1. Right, if you had something like 5x squared as your leading term, or if you had something like negative 27x squared as your leading term, you know, something like that. So let's start out by looking at the product of 2 binomials using the FOIL process, and then we're going to kind of reverse it and see how we can go back to this. So we're going to go from this to a trinomial, and then from the trinomial back to this form. So doing FOIL, we start with the first term. So x times x is x squared. So again, this is a given. When you have 1x squared or just x squared, when you go backwards, you know you're going to have x and x, right? So the first terms in each polynomial are a given. Then the outer, you have x times 10, which is just plus 10x. The inner, you have 1 times x, which is plus 1x. And the last is 1 times 10, which is just plus 10. So we combine like terms here. We have 10x plus 1x. So we're going to end up with x squared plus 11x plus 10. Okay, so if I was given this and I was told to go back to this format, what would I do? Well, I know that I would start with x and x. That's pretty easy, right? X times x gives me x squared, right? How would I get this spot here and this spot here? Well, let's think about it. We know that we multiplied the outer terms, x times 10 to get 10x, and the inner terms, 1 times x to get 1x. We know those combine to give us 11x. So in other words, this coefficient here of 10 plus this coefficient here of 1 added together to give me this coefficient here that's on my middle term. So 10 plus 1 gave me 11. So 10 plus 1 gave me 11. Then notice that the same two integers, 1 and 10, multiplied together to give me this last term here. So 1 times 10 is equal to 10. So that tells me that what I need to find for these two spots here are two integers that sum to 11, or this middle coefficient here, and that have a product of the last term there. So two integers, again, let me repeat, two integers whose sum is the coefficient of the middle term, okay? The coefficient for the variable raised to the first power, and whose product is going to be the constant term. So give me two integers that fit that criteria. If you didn't know this, you would think about the last term here, which is 10, and you would think about the possibilities. Now, of course, you could do negative times negative here, but because all the signs are positive, I would just think about positive numbers. So 10 can be found by 1 times 10, or you could also do 2 times 5, okay? 2 times 5 won't work because 2 plus 5 is 7. 7 does not equal 11, right? We need something that sums to 11. But 1 and 10 does. 1 plus 10 gives me 11. 1 times 10 gives me 10. So I know I would need plus 1 here and plus 10 here. Okay? So pretty easy. The first time you hear it, it might not make sense. It might not all register. But as we work through a few examples here, you're going to be like, oh, this is a very, very easy process. All right, let's take a look at another one. So we have x squared plus 3x minus 28. Again, very easy to factor this. I'm just looking for this right here and this right here. This guy right here is a given. This is going to be x and x. I don't need to worry about that. This guy right here, this last term, is a negative 28. So because it's a negative, it can only be produced from a positive times a negative. So I know I have different signs. So to remind myself of that, I might as well just say a plus and a minus, okay? Because I'm going to have alternating signs. And the order here doesn't matter, right? I could put the plus here, the minus here, doesn't matter, okay? So let's just think about positive 28. We'll work out the signs in a minute. And I want to think about how I can multiply two numbers together to get 28. So what could I do? I could do 1 and 28. I could do 2 and 14. I could do 4 and 7. And that's basically it. So now I want to think about two numbers here that would give me this middle term of plus 3. So that tells me that the bigger number is going to be positive. So if I did 28 minus 1, that would be 27. That's not 3, so that's not going to work. So you can take this out. Then if I did 14 minus 2, that would give me 12, so that doesn't work. If I did 7 minus 4, that's 3, so that's going to be my big winner. So I know that I would need a negative 4 and a positive 7. Again, the way I know that is, if this is plus 3, that's only going to come from a positive 7 minus a 4, or a positive 7 plus a negative 4. So that's why I have a minus 4 and a plus 7. Now to check this, we can FOIL. X times x is x squared. The outer would be minus 4x. The inner would be plus 7x. And the last would be minus 28. Combine like terms here, you'd have plus 3x. So you'd have x squared plus 3x minus 28, which again is what we started with right here. Okay, so we know we have the correct factorization. All right, let's take a look at another one. So we have 5x squared plus 10x minus 15. You might see this problem and say, whoa, we're supposed to be dealing with easy ones. What's going on with this 5 in front of the x squared? Well, relax for a minute. You might want to look at every term here and see, can I pull something out? Always, always, always when you're factoring, as a rule, before you do anything, ask yourself the question, is there something that I can pull out from each term other than a 1 or a negative 1? Because that's going to save you from additional factoring later on, okay? So I notice that everything here is divisible by 5. If I pull that out inside the parentheses, I would have x squared plus 2x minus 3. And now I just need to factor this part, okay? So I'd have 5, and then inside the parentheses, I know this would be an x, and this would be an x. And then give me two integers whose sum is 2 and whose product is negative 3. 3 is a prime number. I can only get 3 from 1 times 3. So it's a question of, can I arrange this in such a way that I get a positive 2 as a sum and a negative 3 as a product? Well, yes, I can. I can do plus 3 and minus 1, right? Because if I take positive 3 and I subtract away 1, I get 2. If I take positive 3 and I multiply by negative 1, I get negative 3, right? And if you want to check this, first you would multiply your two binomials together. So x times x is x squared. The outer would be negative x. The inner would be 3x. Sum those together, you get 2x. And the last would be minus 3. Now we need to multiply this by 5 to get back to our original. 5 times x squared is 5x squared. 5 times 2x is plus 10x. And then 5 times negative 3 is minus 15. So this matches this exactly. 5x squared plus 10x minus 15. 5x squared plus 10x minus 15. All right, for the last problem, we're going to look at one that kind of trips students up a little bit. So we have 6x squared minus 90xy plus 324y squared. So the reason this is a little bit more complicated is because it has two variables involved. But really, if you just kind of follow the simple technique that I'm going to show you here, it's not going to be any harder, okay? So start out by, again, asking the question, can I pull anything out? Well, yeah, I can pull out a 6. This is divisible by 6. 90 is divisible by 6. 324 is divisible by 6. This is 6 times 15. This is 6 times 54, okay? I can't pull any variables out because I have an x here and an x here, but no x here. I don't have a y here, but I have a y here and here, so nothing that's common to everything. So if I pull out the 6, I would have x squared minus 15xy plus 54y squared. Okay, so erase this, and I'll kind of scooch this up just a little bit. Bring that up there. All right, so I'm looking to factor what's inside. So I'm going to set up my two binomials. So I'm just going to put x here and x here. Now, In terms of the y, think about this last term for a minute. We end up with y squared here. How do you get y squared as a product? Because remember, this has to come from this times this. It has to be y times y. So go ahead and just write y and then forget about it, okay? You don't need to think about it again. If they give you this two variable scenario, that's all you need to do. Take the thing that's squared here and again, figure out y times y will give me y squared. If it was z squared, it would be z times z. If it was q squared, it'd be q times q, you know, so on and so forth. I only now need to think about the negative 15 and the 54, okay? So give me two integers that sum to negative 15 and that give me a product of positive 54. I know that has to be a negative and another negative, okay? Two negatives sum to be a negative and two negatives multiply to give me a positive, okay? So that's how I know that. So thinking about factors of 54, I've got 1 times 54. I've got 2 times 27. None of these would work. I've got 3 times 18, and that still wouldn't work. But then I come across 6 times 9. So 6 times 9 is 54. Now, again, I want negative 6 and negative 9. So negative 6 times negative 9 is positive 54, and negative 6 plus negative 9 is going to give me negative 15. So that's what I want. I want a negative 6 and a negative 9. So I've got my minus 6 here and my minus 9 there. And that's it, okay? You can go through and check this with FOIL. Very easy to do. And I would just put my 6 out in front. X times X is X squared. The outer would be minus 9XY. The inner would be minus 6XY. So if we combine like terms here, we have X and X, both raised to the first power. Y and Y, both raised to the first power. So you just want to do negative 9 minus 6, which is negative 15. So minus 15 times XY. And then the last, we have negative 6y times negative 9y. That's plus 54. Again, y times y is y squared. Okay? So very easy to do. And if we want to finish this process, 6 times x squared is 6x squared. 6 times negative 15xy is minus 90xy. And then finally, 6 times 54 is 324. And then times y squared. So again, we end up with exactly what we started with. If we factor this guy, we end up with 6 times the quantity x minus 6y times the quantity x minus 9y.